time together as we celebrate the homegoing of Kelly Don Crim. And I appreciate you being here, as does the family. And I want you to get to know a little bit that you may not have known about Kelly. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin. Father in heaven, we love you. And we thank you for every rich blessing in life. We thank you, Father, for those who come into our lives and we get to share time on this earth with. And then, Lord, we can celebrate their homegoing, and we are reminded that this earth is not our home, but we are merely pilgrims passing through. Father, that today we might examine our own hearts and prepare for the time when you call us home. Lord, we pray for a peace that passes understanding for this family. Give them comfort, give them peace. Let them know, Lord, that you've not given up any authority and that you are in charge.
Yes.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
We are thankful for your son, Jesus, and his great love of us and his sacrifice that we might have eternal life with you. Bless our time together. Speak to us through your word, and we'll give you the praise. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
This morning, join with me as we listen to Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
mystery of the song Amazing Grace. It is the most beloved of Christian songs and has been sung all over the world. And the words are so meaningful because the man who wrote it had operated a slaving ship and was about the most despicable human on the face of the earth. And in the last days of his life, he penned Amazing Grace and joined a monastery to finish out his life. It's amazing, the grace of God and his love for us. I read the obituary of this family this morning. Kelly was born January 25th, 1965 in McKinney, Texas, to Don Wayne and Lana Risa Crim. He passed away Sunday, May 16th, 2021 at Texoma Medical Center. He graduated from Plano East High School and was involved in Special Olympics, where he won lots of medals in bowling. He brought joy to all he came in contact with. To know Kelly was to love him. Kelly's passion was collecting Hot Wheels cars, Batman, Star Wars, Spider-Man, paraphernalia, and watching cartoons. He was also an avid corny dog and cheeseburger connoisseur. And I think he was pretty proud of that. I don't think there was any problem. I will tell you, after 50 years of gospel ministry, this is the first time I have shared a service with Yoder. This is new to me, but I do love the collection and the Hot Wheels cars. Oh, he loved those Hot Wheels. Had them displayed in his bedroom on one of those visits. See, you all know my wife, and you think how sweet and how wonderful she is. There is a meanness in this woman. And she delighted in telling Kelly, poor Kelly, who had them all lined up in the proper order, she was going to rearrange them. And oh, he don't do that. No. And then she said, well, I'm going to let my grandkids come and play with them.
No,
that was not. And of course, they didn't. But it just aggravated. And he would just make a noise like, oh, yeah, when she would start in with that. But I've known him for several years and his family, and the privilege of being their pastor. We had a special parking place for Kelly. He was the only one in a wheelchair at that time. We checked into doing markings on our church parking lot for the handicapped and so forth, and found out that if you do that, you have to commit so many parking spaces, and we were a small country church, and it just pretty well would have taken all the parking spaces. So instead, we put a sign up that was Kelly Don Crim, parking only. And it solved the problem. And we rejoiced when he was able to come. And Don was so faithful to bring him. And your faithfulness, Don, has been an inspiration to a lot of people. And I'm sorry that your back's not in better shape, but we appreciate you and your commitment to that and to the family. We, this day, share in the loss and the victory. And it's both. But think of the victory that he has claimed this day. To the family, we love you. And at this time, we want to hear Joanna Smith and her daughters. Joanna, come.
Thank you.
Sister Shannon Crim of Van Alstine, nephew Will Doughton, wife Paula and their son Jack, niece Brooke Forbus and husband Chris, uncles Carrie Reeser, Carol Crim, James Crim and Dan Poland, aunts Betty Crim, Lisa Johnson, Shonda Poland, and numerous cousins and friends. Kelly is also survived by special caregivers Beta Terry, Carolyn Becker, Teresa Ed, and Dee White. Kelly's preceded in death by grandparents, Carl Reeser, Roberta Allen, and Francis and J.B. Crim. There is always a scripture that I enjoy sharing. Anytime Christians and family come together, it is, of course, the 23rd Psalm. It is a psalm that has been translated into every known language on the face of the earth. It's a psalm that David wrote in a time of trial, in a time of struggle, and when he wasn't sure about the future. And this is what he wrote. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul, leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. In the Old Testament, David knew that he was in the presence of God, and he knew that God had a plan for his life. He knew what it was like to go through the valley of the shadow of death. And the fact that he survived so often was a miracle of God's, because he had a plan for him. And one of the promises he made to David was that his lineage, his family would go, and the kings would come and go, and throughout history he would not be forgotten. And then come forward, and 1,000 years later, as Jesus Christ is born to his lineage, and to this day, when we celebrate Christmas and we celebrate the resurrection of Easter, we celebrate with 1 billion Christians around the world because of the promises of God that David knew and believed and penned in this passage. We're going to have another song
another of my favorites, How Great Thou Art. Scripture and said, well, maybe you can help me. Sometimes I get lucky and am able to help folks with scripture, a particular one they're looking for. And she mentioned she was looking for something of comfort. And I said, well, where are you? And she said, well, I'm in the second chapter of John. And I said, well, you're in a good book. Go over to the 14th chapter. And that's where the message is this morning. The 14th chapter of John. And it's the words of Jesus. He is with his disciples. And he's coming to the close of his ministry. They have had the Last Supper. And he has just told them that he's going to be leaving them. And from the 14th chapter of John, I read the words of Jesus. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe in me also. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way, you know. But Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not where you're going, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. And no man cometh unto the Father but by me. The one instruction I had about this funeral service was to proclaim Jesus.
That's right.
And that's what I'm doing this day. I want to proclaim Jesus with everything we do.
Amen.
The first verse is an unusual way to start a new chapter. Let not your heart be troubled. Why would he say something like that? Because their hearts were troubled. Now understand something. These 12 disciples had been with him and seen the miracles. Two of them had gone with him to the Mount of Transfiguration and seen him transfigured there in the presence of God. They had seen him raise the dead. They had seen him bring back Jared's daughter. All those miracles they had witnessed. And yet when he said to them, let not your heart be troubled, they were worried. They didn't want to be separated. I don't care how prepared you think you are. When someone passes, there's a loss. And there's a hole in your heart, if you will. A place that's now looking to be fulfilled. And we must believe that God, who gave us His Scripture and gave us His Son, will be there as He said He would. And as He produced Jesus for that very purpose. Jesus. Trouble? Have a belief in Jesus about your troubled hearts. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm asked when I go out to Red River, New Mexico, and preach out there and other places, the one question I get asked the most, I mean, I'm introduced as a retired Baptist preacher, so they pretty well know where I'm coming from. But they'll ask, you know, there are new translations, and they'll name whatever it is. Is that okay? Is that translation okay? Because I read from the King James Version. Now, I read from the King James Version, the main reason, all my scripture memory is there, growing up. And it sounds right. I'm comfortable with it. But my answer to them is, as you know, I always use the King James, but do you know which Bible you should use? And now I've got their attention. And the answer is, you should use the Bible you will read and then do what it says.
Amen.
Now, you pick the translation from there. I have seen some of the others, and I don't care particularly. I have no problems with them. I just don't care for them. One of the newer versions, I went to the 14th chapter of John because I love it, and I was reading, and it said, in my Father's house were many apartments.
Apartments.
My God, who created the universe and created this earth and all the miraculous that is here, makes apartments because he's not great enough to make mansions?
Amen.
I don't live in an apartment. I want to live in a mansion.
Amen.
Now, mine doesn't have to be all that big, but I want it to be a mansion, not an apartment. And then I heard a preacher say, you know, when we get to glory, whoever we had the most trouble with on earth, when we die, they're going to be our next door neighbors in glory. And I thought, I don't want to think about that. I'm not ready to deal with that right now. God's Word, the same yesterday, today, and forever. It is true when He says, and I prepare a place for you. You see, there are no surprises with God. God has never said and will never say, I didn't see that coming, because He's God. He knows the hour we were born. I read that when I read the obituary, the very day that we were born. And then it has the day that we pass. God knows. When he created us, he knows. Now, I have to tell you, when it comes to the why questions of things, I have no answers, and I've not found anybody else that has the answers to the why questions. Why does this one suffer and this one not? Why did this one live so long and this one not? Why would a 16-year-old boy be taken that had influenced so many people in a positive way? I cannot answer other than to say, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
He knows what he's doing. I heard an example many, many years ago of somebody making a beautiful bouquet and gathering the flowers for the bouquet. And when God takes a flower for his bouquet, blessed be the name of the Lord. He does what he does because he's God. And he has seen the future, and he knows what's best. No surprises for God. And in the third verse he says, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. That means something pretty special to me, and receive you to myself. I had a grandfather in my early days as a young lad growing up, and we would go visit the grandparents. And I didn't know him when he was a young man and in his strength. I saw some pictures and had to ask, who's this? Here was a vibrant man with big muscles, and he worked in a coal mine, and for entertainment he had lifted weights. That's very troublesome to me, but he entertained himself lifting weights. And I asked, who is this? And they said, that's your granddad, that's Pop. And I couldn't believe it, because by the time I came along, he looked like a 90-year-old man ought to look. He walked with a cane. I remember him tapping that cane on the floor, and everybody kind of quieted down to see what he wanted to say. But he said something that I have remembered my whole lifetime. He said, you know, I see the way the world is going. Now remember, I was a lad. He said, I believe Jesus is going to come in my lifetime. And here he was, 50 years of deacon at the First Baptist Church of Irving, Texas. And he was just as sure of that as anything in this earth. Jesus was going to come in his lifetime. And on a Sunday morning, as he sat in church with the deacons on their official pew in the First Baptist Church, Jesus did come and took him home.
Yeah.
And for Kevin, Jesus did come also. These frail bodies that we have, and I'll speak personally, I won't talk about your body, are frail. In the good days, they're frail. That's why when we get to glory, we need a new body. And the one I want's taller and thinner. I've got some ideas. And I'm sure God won't ask me what I want. He's already got it all planned. But his promise is true. Jesus said, if I go, I'm coming again. And that's the promise we can hold on to, because it's so absolutely true. He told them that if the temple, the worship of God, was destroyed, then in 3 days he would build it back again. And of course they told him he was crazy. They told him how many years it took to build Solomon's temple. They missed most of what he said. It was the worship of God which was done through him. He would come back in 3 days, and that's exactly what he did in the resurrection. A young mother who had just lost her baby, I stood by her side at the graveside after the service. With tears in her eyes, she asked me, will my baby know me in heaven? And I said, the scripture speaks specifically to that. Now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face, we're going to see clearly. We're going to know even as we are known. Of course you'll know your baby. Will I be able to hold it and carry it? Your baby will know you. We'll know each other. If it's a place of glorious resurrection, if it's a place of celebration, Christians are going to know Christians. The Bible accounts for the knowing of the prophets that have gone on before, and they didn't even have a picture, so they didn't know what the prophets looked like, but they recognized them on the Mount of Transfiguration, called them by name. They called Moses. They called Elijah. We're going to know our family. We're going to know our loved ones. We're going to know those grandparents that have gone on. Jesus is going to return as he said he would. Jesus will take us home. In verse 4, he says, and where I go, you know, and the way, you know. Now, Thomas gets a bad rap here. What's his first name? Doubting. Thank you. Now, I'm sure his mother did not name him Doubting Thomas, but that's what history has recorded him as. But understand, he just says what everybody else was thinking, and he said it out loud. Lord, we know not where thou goest. How can we know the way? And Jesus said something that was so profound. I was in ministry many years before I really saw the truth of what he said. Let me go back to the Old Testament for just a minute, if you'll allow me. Do you remember the occasion when Moses is before a burning bush and God has told him that he's going to come out and lead the children of Israel out of Egypt, and they will follow him because God will put it in their heart? And he says, well, what name shall I give them when they say, who sent you? By what authority do you come to lead us out of Egypt? By what authority do you go and stand before Pharaoh and tell him to let us go? Now, understand, Moses had been raised to be the Pharaoh of Egypt. And he knew the name of every god and every goddess that Egypt had. And there was a bunch of them. And so his question is, what name do I use when I stand before these Egyptians and before Israel, before your chosen people? And God gives him this statement. You tell them, I am sent you. A Hebrew emphatic, of which there is nothing else. I am sent you. Listen to the words of Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and life. There is none other. I gave a young man a lift the other day. His car had flamed out beside the road. And sympathetically, I stopped and realized there was nothing I was going to be able to do to help him with his car. So I said, can I give you a lift? Do you have a cell phone? He said, I got nobody to call, but man, if you could give me a lift, I just live right over this side of White Rock, which was not far from my home and no trouble at all. And I had a friend with me, and so we engaged him in conversation as we drove him home. And as to where he'd gone to school, you know, school teachers always want to know that. And some information, and the young man said that he lived there, this side of White Rock, and that he'd actually gone to Van Alstine for a while. And he said, now he's trying to straighten up his life. And I said, well, how are you fixed with the Lord? Do you know Jesus? And he said, well, I'm trying to straighten up my life. I'm trying to get better. And sadly, I knew what he meant. There is a misunderstanding in this world that if you work hard enough and you do enough good things, then probably you'll be all right to go to heaven. That's the world.
Nah.
That's not God's word. God's word are the words of Jesus. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. I cannot tell you, as we've done revivals and things over the years, how many people have tried to tell me about their works, about their devotion, about their sincerity. On the steps of a house, I stood on the porch. They didn't invite us in, and so we had a meeting on the porch. And I asked if they were prepared to meet God, if they were prepared. And they wanted to tell me, my daddy was a deacon. My mother worked in the nursery. Was that my question? I'm glad Dad was a deacon. I'm glad Mom probably volunteered in that nursery and handled and took care of those children, those babies. And I admire that. But you know what? Mom can't get you into glory. Dad can't get you into glory. It's you and Jesus Christ our Lord. Because when he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, there is no other way but that. And then he said, for no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Kelly knew Jesus, claimed his reward at his homegoing. Don't cry for me should be the instruction of every Christian when God gives me my reward and takes me to glory. And Father, we praise you this day that you gave your Son Jesus for us. Amen. Not because we were worthy, certainly not because we deserved it, but Father, because of your love. Join with me now as we listen to a song that swept onto the stage and is so meaningful and speaks to our hearts. I can only imagine.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
If you will, just to stand right up and join me as we pray together. As we pray. Father in heaven, we love you. And we thank you for every rich blessing of life that you give. We are grateful for those you bring into our lives, Lord, and then we share their homegoing together. Father, we are grateful for this family and their influence, and we pray now that calm that only you can give, and a peace and an understanding. Father, strengthen us today to be better servants of you. Let us be always reminded that everything in this world is about you and about your Son, Jesus. May we glorify him with our lives. Father, anybody that doesn't know him as their personal Savior, this day can be a change point in their lives. Let us come humbly to you, Father, and let us make the decisions we need to make. Forgive us now of our failures. Strengthen us in our weaknesses. Give us courage. For, Father, we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.